And welcome to this, not only to our Facebook Live, this also will eventually become a podcast. You know, there's so many things going on in the world today, and it's so fast-paced, it's just hard to keep up with all the critical stories that people need to be aware of. We talk about the persecution of Christians in different areas around the world. And what we want to do is with philosopher and constitutional law expert Bruce Fine, is bring into focus what is really going on in the country of Nigeria. What we're about to share with you that's going on in the country of Nigeria, where almost 50 million people could lose their lives, is just going to blow you away. And Nigeria, believe it or not, Nigeria has become the most dangerous place for Christians in the world. And you're asking, what did he just say? Yes. Nigeria has become the most dangerous place for Christians in the world. Bruce Fine, who was there recently, who spent time there, has come back with a startling report. This is his first interview, and we're breaking news here. Bruce, tell us what you saw and what is actually going on. Because when we think of Nigeria, we think of Boko Haram and the kidnapping of children, but it's much more deep and much more pervasive than what we know.
And not only that, but in terms of the numbers, for example, when I was there recently, even before my arrival, in the northern Nigerian states, and you've got to remember, 12 of those states have Sharia laws enshrined as their legal code. It's just not advisory. It is the legal code, you know, cut off hands and stoning women and that kind of thing. But in these 12 northern states, there was a youth group. It gave a quit order to 11 million Biafrans who reside and have businesses there, saying, if you don't leave your home and business by October 1, we will destroy you. And the government did nothing. This are Hausi Fulani, radical Islamics, who made the threat. As we're sitting here today, that October 1st date hangs like a sword of Damocles over 11 million Christian Biafrans. That's twice who perished in the Holocaust. Moreover, in the southeast, where the Biafrans predominate numerically, the Hausi Fulani are killing children in churches. Just in the last 48 hours, they've begun an assault. It's called Operation Python Dance, where the Hausi Fulani soldiers are coming in. They're taking youths. I could put pictures if you had. They've sent to me. They've shot them. They're lying down dead in the water in industrial scale. And this is because the Hausi Fulani, who are very, if you want to put an accurate term, almost backward economically. And the Biafrans are much more educated and skilled economically, so they prosper. And they reside in much of the oil area of Nigeria. And the Hausi Fulani, who are radical Islamists, youths who have very little, you know, economically, they have to, they're preying on their Christian brethren. And the government is doing nothing. In fact, it's participating with the military.
Are you telling me that the president of Nigeria has become a sympathizer to this, where you actually can go into religious gatherings, churches, and you can just kidnap and kill innocent people?
With impunity.
With impunity, and they say and do nothing?
They do nothing. For example, I mean, I am a lawyer. I'm suing 16 members of the armed forces. We can't sue President Buhari because he's got immunity, because they have gone in and slaughtered and killed Christian Igbos. It's a pending lawsuit in the U.S. District Court in the District of Columbia, and there's no sanctions. There's no punishment for any of these members of the armed forces. Boko Haram is tiny compared. You're talking about hundreds. We're talking about millions here.
Forget about the government. Why is there not an outcry from the people in the community? Why is there not an outcry from people who care, who know some of these children and these families? And why no outcry from the media? Why are we just hearing about this for the first time?
Well, part of it, I think, Armstrong, is that lots of groups are not sophisticated with regard to the media. And, you know, the media responds to attention-getting efforts. And when you have basically a boycott, and I guarantee if you're a reporter, you're not going into Enugu, that's the capital basically of Biafra, because it's difficult to get there, and so they don't cover it. And in part two, I think President Buhari had done a good snow job. He came here about a year ago during the Obama administration. He spoke at the Peace Institute of all places while he's conducting war against his own people. And you're right, the idea is, well, he's fighting Boko Haram, so we'll kind of squint at all the other things that he's doing. We sell him arms, and as from time to time, you know, Nigeria has oil. We have to keep them, like Saudi Arabia, in our good graces to get the oil flowing. And it's a total marginalization of a whole staggering number of people simply because it doesn't follow into the real politique of the time.
How many people have died?
Well, tens of thousands. And it's hard to keep the numbers there. I mean, if you just look at the row on row of these youths, bloodied, dead,
you actually saw?
No, they're the pictures. I just got them in the last 48 hours where I'm being sent these pictures on Facebook and on Twitter. And some of it is video.
Where's the United Nations?
Yeah, that is a good question. Where it's like Rwanda all over again, right? Yeah, it is. Because the definition of genocide is attempting to exterminate in whole or in substantial part because of your religion or ethnicity. And this is both. It's their Christian religion, their ethnicity is Igbos. They want to destroy them, plunder all of their property. And you'd figure, well, where's the United Nations? Where's the High Commissioner on Refugees and on human rights? Right now, he is, at least he's deploring Burma's expulsion of and I don't want to exonerate them, of Muslims into Bangladesh. And this is on a scale that makes Bangladesh Muslims in a tea party.
But you're making President Buhari of Nigeria, you're describing someone who is as if worse than ISIS. He does it under auspices of his leadership as a head of state. Yeah. I mean, and what he's inflicting upon the people of his country is nothing like we've seen anywhere.
Yeah, well, that is exactly right. It's really good. I don't know whether I'm a little bit older than you. Maybe I don't look at the effort, the Biafran War, 1967 to 70. 2 million Biafrans died in that war, and it was provoked by similar kinds of sense of persecution and marginalization of the Igbos, in part because Nigeria really should have never been a country that tried to combine Yoruba and Hausa, Fulani and Igbos under a single roof. It just didn't make any sense. And what you end up with is the majority oppresses the minority, and especially since historically the Hausa, Fulani dominated the military, they had the guns, and so they just shot and dominated by force and violence and threats and intimidation.
But how do we stop, for our listeners, how do we stop the genocide? What needs to happen to stop what's going on in Nigeria and bring it to the world attention?
Well, what I have suggested and encouraging members of Congress, we need to get an international arms embargo on Nigeria. We need to have the UN Security Council designate particular people that should be investigated for the crime of genocide to be tried for the International Criminal Court, which has been done in other cases. We need to get these people who are complicit in the genocide listed. There's a recent law passed in the waning months of the Obama administration. It's called the Global Magnitsky Human Rights Accountability Act, where the president can designate people who are implicated in gross violations of human rights for a denial of visas, and their assets are frozen. There's a stigma attached. So those are the efforts that your constituents can recommend to their legislators in Congress and the United States Senate, and writing President Trump directly. Because remember, it was President Trump and especially Vice President Mike Pence. He attended a world summit on persecution of Christians globally in Mayflower Hotel here in Washington, D.C. in last May, and where he made all these statements that President Trump is going to stand up and against these radical Islamist terrorists who are slaughtering Christians. Well, here's a chance to do so on the strongest scale that's imaginable. And one thing that worries me, Armstrong, among others, aside from the sadness and the compassion you have for these families and people being killed and their lives being destroyed, is if Buhari can get away with this with impunity, what signals does that send to all these other Muslim-dominated radical countries in the Middle East? We don't have any price to pay.
You know, with all the focus on North Korea and its bloody dictator, I mean, this guy also compares in comparison to what's going on in Nigeria. Let me ask you this. Is there a tinge of racism to this? The fact that Nigeria would be seen as a country of Africans? If this were a country where the Buhari was, let's say, a colonialist or a white head of state, would this be a different issue? Do they lessen the value of these laws? lives and the importance of this matter because it's an African dictator?
Well, I think the answer is yes, as crass as that may seem. Well, it's just Africans killing each other, so who really cares about it? Yeah, or Zimbabwe, Mugabe, yeah, it doesn't really matter. You know, human rights are only for white folks. And I think that is a commentary on the whole, you know, the racism is still a very, very prominent element and influencer in international affairs. Because otherwise, in terms of the scale of what's going on there, see, this is not a tiny 50 million. That's a huge number. That's right. Probably larger than 3/4 of all the nations who are members of the United Nations.
Bruce Fein, thank you for this critical update. I'm Armstrong Williams, constitutional lawyer. Bruce Fein will be hearing more about this as in the future. And I'm sure this has become your obsession. You want to make sure that the world knows about this before another child happens.
Yeah, it gets on the agenda. Absolutely, Armstrong. It's critical.
I'm Armstrong Williams. Thank you for joining us.